Thank you, and thanks very much for the opportunity to come back to Lesouches. I was here 3 years ago, and I loved it so much that I was very, very happy to get another invitation to come to this very nice and inspiring place. I thought I'd give you a little bit of kind of 2 minutes introduction, who I am, so that you understand from which point I'm coming at all of this. I'm currently a professor for experimental physics at the University of Glasgow. And it's actually a little bit of a funny story how I got into all of this gravitation wave stuff. I actually went to study physics in order to learn about photovoltaics and stuff like that. And then I met a professor, Carsten Danzmann, in Hanover, who completely distracted me from all I wanted to do and actually pulled me into gravitational waves. And actually, it started all off with, in the first year of my undergrad studies, they were looking for scientific helpers to build the GEO-600 gravitational wave detector, because they got all of their funding cut. And then they had lots of students. And the first thing I was doing there was laying bricks and putting floors into a building, and then later painting walls. And then slowly you were kind of upgraded to deal with, you know, bolting together the vacuum system, and then building some electronics and so on. So that's how I actually came into gravitational wave. And then I went on, did my diploma studies in Germany, so the master's equivalent. I think I was the last student at the Garching prototype, where the Max Planck Institute for Quantum Optics, did my PhD at the GEO-600 detector. So that was a very exciting time, because at that time we tried to test lots of interesting technologies. Many you will see nowadays in A-LIGO, like the monolithic suspensions, Singer recycling, DC readout, photon calibrators, and so on. And then afterwards, and here comes the connection to CNRS, I did one postdoc which was funded by CNRS and INFN to work on the design of the advanced Virgo interferometer for 2 years. And then I went to get a lectureship in Glasgow, and there I worked mainly on advanced LIGO upgrades and third generation and some quantum noise issues. So, and I was mainly invited initially for doing the third generation stuff, and then later on the quantum noise stuff was bolted on. So we will have 5 lectures, and I thought we do it the following way, how we split them. They're not all lectures. Some of them will be a little bit more like seminars. Some will be more like lectures. And then I thought we also do a little bit of some practical sessions. So I thought the plan is today we start with a big overview of quantum noise, all of the fancy technologies, just to get an intuitive understanding of them. Then we will have a second lecture on quantum noise, where we do the mathematical framework, the two-photon formalism, how to deal with, you know, how to calculate all of these. And then we have 3 sections on third generation. And I thought we do it the following way. We do one where I give you an overview again, what's out there. And then the other 2 sessions will be practical sessions where you guys can design either your third generation detector or a certain aspect of that. Okay, and we'll come later on to how we do these 2 sessions. Okay, so that's a little bit of experiment. If it goes wrong, then we find some other way to fill the time and we go back to the classical style. But I thought it's much, much easier for you to engage with stuff and remember the stuff if you do something your own rather than me, blah, 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 for many, many hours. Good. Any questions? Any concerns about that? Say again?
Did you just tell us that funding cuts were good for
you? They were an aspect. I mean, I'm not sure what actually was good for my career. When students ask, you know, how do you do this? How do you get a professorship? I always tell people, you know, that at least in my life, it was a very big lottery. And if many things would have gone my way, how I wanted them to go, I wouldn't be here where I'm right now. Okay, so for example, when I started, I did my diploma at the Garching prototype, and then I went and wanted to have a lab experiment in Hanover at the Max Planck Institute. But the people who run GEO said, oh, we want you to come to GEO. And I said, no, I don't want to be that. Because what I heard was all of the stress, you know, the time stress there, you know, certain things, you know, if the laser break, you can't, you know, can't do anything else with the detector. So you rely on many other people. And I said, you know, I want to be responsible for the stuff I'm doing and want to be annoyed about myself if something doesn't work rather than other people and so on. So they convinced me then to go there, or I think Danzmann just said, you know, you have to go there for 3 days a week, 2 days a week, you can do your own lab stuff. And then in the end, after 2 months, I didn't go back to my lab anymore at all, because I was so excited by GEO-600, okay? But if I would have chosen, it would have been completely different path, okay? And that's many, many different things. So I think careers are very hard to plan, and if people want to talk about this, you know, I can give you my personal take of it, but I'm not sure how representative it is and how much you can learn from it, but happy to talk about it. Good. Quantum noise and quantum non-demolition techniques. So let's start with a little bit of a disclaimer. So the key thing here is really what we want to learn is, I mean, all of this quantum noise, standard quantum limit is more or less the equivalent to the Heisenberg uncertainty as we see in a little bit. And what I would like to do in this lecture is to give you some intuitive understanding, not with equations, but actually with lots of pictures, the ball on a stick picture actually, or the graphical quadrature picture, to see how you can evaluate this noise and how you can actually beat this noise. And then, as I said, the mathematical description, which actually gets quite complicated, we will do then on Monday. So quantum non-demolition, that's actually a very, very funny field in the sense that it's a very old field. So most of the foundations of this were led by very clever Russian professors in the 1980s. And it took the experimentalists quite some time to catch up with this, okay? So many of the things you will see in these lectures were proposed in the 80s and 90s. And nowadays, 20, 30 years later, we are far enough on the experimental side that we can actually build these things and actually need to use them, okay? So that's quite an interesting thing where we are out of sync between what the theoretical thinking is and what the experimental thinking is. And obviously quite a bit of this detail or of this gap comes thinking, you know, on paper about a certain noise source or concept, then everything is always easy, you know, you don't have any losses, all of your mirrors are perfect. But in reality, in our experiments, obviously, you never get your perfect mirror with a perfect reflectivity, no losses, perfect curvature, perfect mirror flatness, and so on. And that's why things, in our case, get usually a bit more complicated. Also, one disclaimer on just notation. So many people always use this term quantum non-demolition experiments, and it's actually a science in itself to define what is quantum non-demolition, and many people in the field use different terms for this, and strictly some of the schemes I will show you don't qualify to some of these definitions. So I will refer to QND and QNR interchangeable, so let's just call any technique, or we talk about techniques which somehow allow you to reduce quantum noise in a detector. So if you think about spectral densities, to push this noise further down. Good, and I think that's all about disclaimers, so let's start. So as an introduction, we'll just talk about what quantum noise is, the standard quantum limit, how this all relates to so-called vacuum fluctuations, and then we get to the quadrature picture. So if I want to build a gravitational wave detector, what are the first few things I have to do? Can you summarize what you need to do in order to build a gravitational wave detector? If you would have to put some basic principles on there, what do you need to do? Yeah? The masses, they need to be approximately free, yes? What else? What characteristics do you need to give to these masses? It's partly in your free already in there, okay? So it's not only suspension, but you need to make your test masses very quiet, okay? So you need to have some pieces of, in our case, glass, where, you know, the center of mass of these pieces of glass sits somewhere very, very quietly, is not disturbed, so that hopefully the signal that you want to get, the motion or the tidal forces of the gravitational waves are larger than what you need. Okay, and that's something which takes probably most of the money and most of the engineering in a gravitational wave detector. Okay, so you have these brilliant pieces of glass which are suspended from glass fibers. All of this sits in a vacuum system so that you don't have acoustics pushing them around, that you don't have any kind of gas molecules kicking your mirrors. So lots and lots of engineering to make them very quiet. That's the first part of my gravitational wave detector. Now I have my masses sitting there completely quiet, or not, never completely quiet, you know, never works like that. Nothing is ever perfect, but they are sitting there, and if a certain gravitational wave from a close by supernova or a binary black hole somewhere in a distant galaxy comes by, we would have a length change between the two centers of mass of your two test systems. So what do I need to do now if I want to detect gravitational waves with this system? Exactly. So I have made it all quiet, but now I need to do the measurement. And that's the key part where the quantum noise actually comes in there, because we have a challenge here. And the challenge is, you need to read out first of all your differential arm length degree with a very high accuracy. So you need to make your accuracy higher, obviously, than the signal that you expect. Otherwise, you wouldn't see it. You would just see the noise. And now comes a tricky bit in, if we think about quantum mechanics here. I need to achieve this very, very high accuracy in my measurement without putting a disturbance into my system, which I can never avoid if I do a measurement, that is larger than what I want to see. Okay, very simple terms. Okay, and that's in principle all you need to know for a gravitational wave detector. Make your free falling test masses very, very quiet. Need to read it out with high accuracy, and then make sure your measurement process doesn't spoil your readout. Okay, obviously a bit more simplified, but I find it always very useful to think in these kind of three different terms, because then you can sort, you know, what do I do for what reason. One thing I haven't put in here is that obviously this is all about, you know, here I assume I have a fixed signal, and then here I just want to read out the signal, don't spoil it. What I can do, and we will see some techniques, is that actually there are tricks to enhance my signal. Okay, if I find a way to enhance my intrinsic signal, then obviously I don't need to read out that accurate anymore, and I don't need to worry too much about putting in some back action. Good, and the equivalence of this, if we think about it, sensing noise or sensing with high accuracy without introducing my back action noise, and we will see where this is without spoiling it from the quantum mechanics point, are what you, I'm pretty sure, have seen before, is photon shot noise. So the noise in our detection, really kind of counting noise on my main photodetector. And then we have photon radiation pressure noise, and we will see where this comes from. This is actually not happening on the photodiode, but that is an interaction of vacuum fluctuations with your test masses pushing them around. And we'll see a bit more details there in a second. Another way to look at all of this, and I guess some people will have seen this before, is again, I mean, it's often stated that the Heisenberg uncertainty limit more or less manifests itself in these instruments or the ensembles of test masses that we look at as the standard quantum limit. We will define that a little bit later. And what it means is, I mean, usually people think about the momentum and the position as the two which don't commute and actually give you an uncertainty, the standard Heisenberg uncertainty. In our measurements, actually, we don't care so much about the momentum. What we are limited by is that we do a continuous measurement of the gravitational wave signal now, in a second, and through different times. So the problem here we have is that my position measurement, when I mean position, I mean the kind of differential arm length degree, but the same would be true for a single test mass, doesn't commute with the measurement at a different time. Good, and I guess people have seen this curve. Peter is nodding, okay, so we have here, you will see many, many, many of these plots. Everybody in our world loves strain plots, which are somehow counterintuitive because you always think about signal to noise ratios, while these plots show you noise to signal ratios, more or less, if you turn it around. And we have here the normal audio band frequency, so we start here from 10 hertz and go to 10 kilohertz. And what I'm sure Peter will have explained to you, you have this kind of cocktail of different noise sources which limit your sensitivity. Most of them are completely, or all of them are completely uncorrelated. So what you can do is actually you can add them all up in quadrature, and then you get this black line which gives you your theoretical sensitivity limit. And this is the case for advanced LIGO. Doesn't look so different for advanced Virgo. And the reason why we are talking here about quantum noise, and why I personally choose to work on this topic, is if you look at the sensitivity here, pink is a quantum noise that's more or less dominating from, I don't know, 12, 15 hertz up to 10 kilohertz. That is the noise source, okay? You can do with all of these other noise sources whatever you want. If you want to get better, you also need to work on the pink one, okay? Good. So, take a very simple approach here just to relate how this quantum noise curves actually come together. Again, in a very intuitive way, What we have is two different effects. I have my light source, and we all know that the photons coming out of this laser follow a certain statistics, the Poisson statistics, and if I just shine my laser onto a photodiode, what I will see is a voltage over time, and it would usually look like a flat line, but if I just zoom in my scope and have enough dynamic range in my measurement equipment, then what I will see is actually at some point that there's a certain fluctuation, and that's a very simple intuitive picture of what actually shot noise is and how it influences our measurement. The second one, the photon radiation pressure noise, that's the more unusual one, and that really stems from the fact that in order to make our test masses free and reduce them from seismic, we suspend our mirrors as test masses, as pendulums, so that they are susceptible to very, very small forces, nano-newton, femto-newton. And then, if you think again, in this very intuitive picture, you shine your laser onto your test mass here. And if you think again of the photons arriving and being reflected here, transferring recoil or momentum onto the mirror as a statistical function, then obviously you see this position here, which is our main signal. Also, if I look just closely enough and have enough measurement accuracy, you see the position of this mirror actually moving. And that gives you this radiation pressure noise. And this is really special for our field. There are very few other fields where you have this because it really relies on or is a consequence of having your mirrors suspended, while in many quantum optics experiments and so on, or cold atoms, if you think about it, all of your optics are bolted down onto the table and you don't have any susceptibility of your mirror position to radiation pressure. I also plug in here, just as a first level of understanding, as I said, we will go deeper and deeper during the lecture, a simple explanation or a simple equation for both of these noise sources. And you see the interesting aspects in here is that my shot noise to first order is actually independent of frequency. Frequency is not showing up anywhere. Just scales with the inverse with the arm length, if we think about strain. While the radiation pressure noise has some interesting features, first of all, it is frequency dependent. Okay, so at high frequencies, it's not so much of a problem. At low frequencies, it's a bigger problem just because of the susceptibility or the transfer function of your mirror here. So transfer function is, for a given force I put in here, how much movement do I get? And that kind of is frequency dependent. At low frequencies, closer to the mirror resonance, I get obviously a stronger response than if I look at very, very high frequencies, where if I modulate a laser beam with power here, you average over many, many cycles before you actually see some response here. Yeah. Very good. Very good point. So, usually, what would you expect to see here? An increase with optical power? Yes, directly increase, linear proportional? Anybody else? Square root, exactly. That's the right thing. So you would expect it to raise with the square root, okay? And now we need to think about how our signal looks like. The problem here is, maybe I should have made talked a little bit more about this. What you see here in this is not just the noise, but it's always your noise calibrated by your signal transfer function. So you always look at the relation of my noise to my signal. And the interesting part here is that the noise, the shot noise, scales with the square root of power, but my signal, what I get out, scales with the power, scales linearly with the power. Okay, so I have one term, my signal scales with the power, with the power, the noise scales with the square root of the power. So if I increase the power, I win in SNR. And now it's actually, again, the other way around, because if we look at these strains, it's not signal to noise, but noise to signal. The further down, the better. So now comes the interesting part here, and you hinted already to this. So there's a frequency dependence in here. One other aspect is there's a mirror mass in here. Obviously, one second. Obviously, the heavier my mirror is here, the less motion I get for a given force. So it helps to make my mirrors heavier. And then we come to the power. But you had a question first? Yes. Oh, just to show that, you know, these two are the same. In principle, there's a there's no frequency dependence in there, but what I show here, you can evaluate at every frequency, okay? So it's really just to show that this is not something, if I would have drawn it like this, some people might have thought, okay, I give it to you at one frequency, but I just want to make sure both of these are, I can choose to plot them at 10 or evaluate them at 100 hertz and so on. Okay, so the scary part in here, or the interesting part here is, that I have these two noise sources now, and now what we always want to do is we want to do better. We will always want to push all of the noise sources down. So for example, if you think about this noise curve here, you want to push down the high frequency part because you want to learn about the tidal disruption of a neutron star merger in order to evaluate your equation of state of a neutron star, or you want to see the core collapse supernova or neutron star modes, whatever is up here in these frequencies. So you want to improve at this frequency range here. But at the same time, you also want to improve at the low frequencies here because you want to pick up more SNR, see your in spirals earlier so that you maybe be able to pre-warn optical telescopes and so on, do parameter estimation in order to determine the formation channels of your black holes, whatever. And all of these, you accumulate the information about this here at low frequency. So you always want to do better and push your whole pink curve down at the same time. And we see an easy way to do this for the shot noise, or the most easy way to do this, is if we just look at this equation here, okay, wavelengths you can change, but you don't get much out of this, only if you go to very, very different wavelengths here. But also the power is dependent here on the wavelength, so you don't win much here. Can you make your instrument longer? For LIGO, for example, that's now not so easy because it's already built. But the one thing you can change is the power, okay? So that's your first parameter if you want to improve on shot noise, is to increase the power. But the problem, and now you see that comes back to an uncertainty relation, if I do very well in this noise here, in the shot noise, unfortunately, because the P shows up one in time in the denominator, one in the numerator, I win at one frequency and I lose at the other frequency. And we will see this a little bit, or in one noise source you win and you lose in another noise source. And that actually then relates to that you can either only win at high frequencies or low frequency. And we will see in a second how this works. Okay, so that was kind of the very, very top level explanation of these. And now we can go a little bit more into detail and actually, oh, why don't we do this on the whiteboard, draw a few pictures, okay? So I now consider a very simple Michelson interferometer here, really nothing else as my laser. I have a beam splitter, two test masses, and then I have my photodetector here, okay? So if we now see how these noise sources scale, let's do the usual thing we do. We have here our strain, and that is in 1 over square root of hertz. And then here we have frequency in hertz. And now let's say we choose a certain power, and we draw our shot noise. And shot noise, which colors can you see? Can you see this one? So this one here is my shot noise. We said that is actually flat. So the next noise source you then have is for this particular power. So this here is, let's call this shot noise for power P or P1. Now we draw the radiation pressure noise, and the radiation pressure noise will look differently because of the coloring here. We have the 1 over f square. So if I draw that, then it somehow, I don't give you units here, so let's make this one here is our radiation pressure of power 1. And now the sensitivity, the overall quantum noise limited sensitivity, and we haven't plotted any of the other noise sources here, will give you the uncorrelated sum of these. So that's my solid line here. Okay. Yes, I'm drawing, sorry. That's so normal for us. All of these plots are always log-log. Apologies for that. Yes, of course. Fabry-Perot's. Okay, that's an interesting question. So what you usually do is, okay, so side note, so your h is usually defined as your delta L over L, okay? And now it depends on where you plug this in. Usually if you would have arm cavities in here, you still have the delta L of this arm, of your 4 kilometers, for example, over the 4 kilometers here, okay? So it's independent on whether you have your arm cavities or not. You always use the normal lengths, your physical lengths, but that's just a convention how you do the definition. It would cancel out if you do it the other way around, okay? Because you have also in your signal transfer function, if I have cavities, I increase my signal transfer function, and that's where you get actually the increase in there, okay? And I should say, please, it's very good that people have questions, so always feel free to interrupt me whenever you think it's useful. Good, so now let's, it's very good that you listen, very good. Okay. So I was asking Peter whether he had covered that, and he said he will cover it in one of the future lectures. So, and that's why I've drawn here no arm cavities. So if you put in a resonator in here, okay, an arm resonator, then what happens is that you get so-called roll-off at very, very high frequencies. Where does this come from? Okay, do I destroy that picture? Okay, so what I put in here with red is not relevant to this part, but just to the question. So what you put in here is you put arm cavities in here. Why do you put the arm cavities in here in first instance? Do you know? Why do I need to do this? Why do I need to go to, why do I want this? Okay, so can you define what is this ideal? Where does this ideal come from? So you want Peter to answer the question? Okay, and so if I plot here a delta A from a gravitational wave, and this is my time, then obviously my delta L, if I have a periodic source like a pulsar, I will have a constant amplitude, so this will be my, I don't know, 10 to minus 22 or something like this, and then I have here, I don't know, if let's say this is 100 hertz oscillation, then here I have 10 milliseconds, okay? So now what you determine as ideal is if I have a normal Michelson interferometer, light goes here and comes back. The question is how much phase do I actually pick up during my measurement period, okay? So if I have a short arm and I put in, now in yellow here, the equivalent of my light travel time, then I go from, let's say if I have a short one, I go from zero to, for example, this point, and what I get, obviously, is the measurement difference, which is very hard to see, it's a tiny phase difference, okay? So I don't get the full signal. If I now get longer and longer, let's for example say my light travel time is equivalent to going from here to here, I get a huge phase difference, okay, between the two arms, okay. If I go even here, it gets larger, but now we can continue this. If you go further and further and further and go over several waves, then what you do is, I mean, in the worst case, you know, my light travel time goes from here to here, so one full cycle, and I wouldn't see any response whatsoever. Yeah, because the phase I have picked up here and the phase I lost in this area completely compensate, okay? So that's why you put in these arm cavities, and for the frequencies we want to observe, let's say 100 hertz or so, you can do the trick, the light travel times, I think you get to something like several hundred, 500 kilometers or 1,000 kilometers is the right arm length, okay? But we see here already what happens if you now go, so we have done this now with travel times, but you can do the same trick actually with frequencies. If I go in with higher and higher frequencies, and if you think about the response of my resonator, so if you look at the transfer function, again, this is log-log of a cavity, then for low frequencies, it's 0, 0, 0, and then it's like any resonance, like a mechanical resonance. Obviously, if you go beyond a certain bandwidth, a corner frequency, actually it falls off, okay? So that's the response of your cavity. And the same, this corner frequency is actually this frequency here, okay? So what happens is if you go for frequency, signal frequencies or displacement of your end mirrors, for higher frequencies, you lose response, where response means how much phase change do I see on my photodiode, while we set our shot noise as flat, okay? And now you think again what I was saying about these curves, there are noise over signal, so my noise stays the same, my signal goes down at high frequencies, so that's why this curve goes up, okay? So that is a feature of these arm cavities, and actually one of the knobs where you can actually play around with the bandwidth of your interferometer, okay? And there are certain scientific reasons, some of them are softer than others, why you want to go for certain bandwidths, okay? But for the moment, ignore this part here. It's not super relevant for us. The key here, and that's why I take now away here again the mirrors in order to not deal with the cavity pole, is actually because then we have everything flat here, okay? More questions? Okay, so now we go for a higher power, because we said, okay, we want to do better at high frequencies here. So we improve our power, and then what we will get is a better shot noise here. So that's my shot noise of my P2, where P2 is larger than P1. And now I have improved at high frequencies, but now you see my radiation pressure component actually increases here with the square root of the power. So now I should label this radiation pressure P2. So now my sensitivity given by the uncorrelated sum of both of these noise sources is this red curve here, and you see I have improved at high frequencies, but I lost at low frequencies, okay? And this is now something where in the initial detectors, and actually even in the second generation detectors, you scale them so that you get the best sensitivity out. For example, if all of your other noise sources, the thermal noise sources or so, lie here underneath, then you don't care about the radiation pressure and you turn up your power as high as you can in order to win here. But if we look at the advanced LIGO sensitivity, for example, you see if you would further on increase your sensitivity or the high frequency sensitivity by increasing the power, you would actually lose here at the low frequency part already. So this is kind of more or less, as I said, softly balanced so that you get an optimal sensitivity, get a good bucket sensitivity, but not spoiling the low frequency, so you put your quantum noise very close to all of these other noise sources here. Good, so now you can do this for any kind of power that you can imagine, and what you get is then several of these points. So if you do another power, you would get the corner point here, but there's no way to get below this kind of envelope of the kind of always the points where the two cross, and this curve here is the so-called standard quantum limit. Okay, and was given, I think that's old, 1980s, as I said, this was invented and was originally thought to be a fundamental noise limit that we couldn't go beyond. Very funny turn in history is then that the same people who invented all of this very fundamental noise limit afterwards invented over the next 20 years 10 different methods to actually surpass this fundamental limit. So very interesting to see the same people doing this. Good, okay, so that's the standard quantum limit, and the slope of the standard quantum limit is actually 1 over f. Okay, so it's this is 1 over f squared, this one here is 1 over f. Good, I think we skip that. So, that took a little bit longer than I thought, but I think it was useful. So now, what we do is we think about, as I said, very basic, just two slides on the mathematical approach, just in order to introduce a quadrature picture, and we will do this properly on Monday. So everything we have seen here obviously relate to the light fields that we have in our interferometers, and in the most general case, I can write any light field I have in the interferometer or hitting my photodiode by this. We have an amplitude here. Then we have the complex amplitude A of R here. You have your angular frequencies in here, and you have some polarization. So the angular frequencies here, omega, if you think about it for light fields, we are talking about 10 to the 15, 10 to the 14 hertz. Okay, so something very, very fast, much, much faster than anything you can detect with a photodiode and resolve. Okay, the light oscillations that will become important later on. So if we now want to look at this, nobody can forbid us, and I'm pretty sure that looks very familiar to you from standard undergrad quantum mechanics, harmonic oscillator descriptions. We can introduce two new properties, and we'll just call them for the moment x1 and x2, which are combinations of these complex amplitudes here. And what we do, or what we name them to, and you will see in a second why this makes sense, we can name these amplitude and phase quadrature, x1 and x2, and then we can rewrite our electric field just as a linear combination of cos and sine terms. Polarization is for us not a key thing here, and here you see where the names come from. The amplitude quadrature has this cos term in here, and the phase quadrature has a sine term in there. Okay, so I don't think there's any big surprises. And the only other thing we need to know for today's lecture is that obviously all of this is classical so far. So now you need to go into quantum field theory and actually quantize everything. And then you get this creation operators here, and you can rewrite your amplitude and your phase quadrature with the A daggers here. Okay, and these two properties here, which you can always think intuitively about these classical fields, the amplitude and the phase quadrature, is what we need to look at in the following. Okay, so I promised you we will not do this by equation, but with graphical pictures, and this is the key to it. Okay, so if I have an electric field now, shoot my laser anywhere, what I guess is usually something I describe as a ball on a stick. So if I take a certain measurement time, and if I have the power to resolve the phase and the amplitude quadrature, then I get individual measurements here, 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 and so on. And the shading here of this ball determines the probability distribution of doing a measurement at a certain point here, and I can define of this light field here, or this light state, a certain uncertainty in amplitude quadrature and in phase quadrature. And these uncertainties actually is what we measure as shot noise, and also what in the interaction with our mirrors pushes the mirrors around. Okay, so it's not a single dot here, but you have this uncertainty. And with this tool, we can actually do quite a few very useful things, because one of the key things to understand if we talk about quantum noise reduction techniques, the state of the art nowadays, is actually to say we don't have to stick with such a noise state here, which has equal contribution in the amplitude and the phase quadrature, but by using nonlinear optics, I can actually play around with these and actually squeeze and stretch them, while obviously the product of the two still needs to be one. Okay, so I can win in one quadrature and I can lose in another quadrature. And we'll come to this in a little bit more, let's say in 10 minutes, in a bit more detail. And now you have kind of all different types of pictures here. Depends on how you define quadratures and so on. But the key thing here is just to remember that what I've shown you so far are coherent states. So really I have a light field and a certain uncertainty around it. But if I don't have the light field, if I switch off my laser, what do I get? The interesting thing is I still get this uncertainty here. Okay, it's not that there's no uncertainty whatsoever. So we have these so-called vacuum states, which you can imagine like virtual photons coming into existence and vanishing very, very quickly again. And you can also, with these vacuum states, actually squeeze them. And this is something we will look at in a second. So how does all of this connect to the interferometers and the shot noise, what I told you so far? So the easiest way to understand this is to think of, we have these vacuum fluctuations everywhere, okay? They might be on top of your laser field here. They might come in through your end mirror here. Or actually, they might come from your photodetector here. And now the interesting thing is to think about which of these fluctuations, vacuum fluctuations or virtual photons, actually make it into my interferometer, interact with my mirrors, push them around, cause radiation pressure noise, and which ones are actually getting to the photodetector to cause shot noise. So I mentioned three points. Let's go. We have some from the dark port or from your photodetector. We have some from the laser and some coming through the end mirrors. Do I need to care about the ones from the laser? Anybody, any opinion? Why no? That would dominate them. Yes. Very good. Okay, so you have quite a lot of light here. The other thing how to think about it is that you have your interferometer locked on the, usually on, you operate them on the dark fringe. Was that something you Peter is nodding, very good, on the dark fringe. So all of your light, in principle, this whole system, if I would draw a box here around my Michaels interferometer, looks from the laser scene as a mirror. So whatever I send in here goes back to the laser. I don't care what is on the laser. That's not where I derive my signal. So not important. What's about this end mirror here? That actually would be interesting, but usually we put the reflectivity of our end mirrors to very, very high, like very, very close to one. So the vacuum fluctuations that leak actually into the interferometer here are attenuated usually by factors 10 to the 5 or something like this because of the reflectivity of the mirror. Now we go for these ones here, the vacuum states entering the interferometer from the dark port. Where do they actually go? They can actually pass into the interferometer here, interact with these mirrors. Okay, and now you might wonder, bloody hell, why should a few virtual photons interacting here with my mirrors where I have kind of megawatts of power in there, why should they actually push around so much? Anybody any explanation? Why is that? I have a megawatt here and I have close to negligible light down here. Where's the difference? Why do I care about this? It's a way how you calculate your light fields. It's a cross term. So you have a bead of 10 to the 6 watts with your vacuum fluctuations, and that bead term is actually the one which dominates in the frequency band that we are interested in. Okay, so you have your tiny, tiny fluctuations which are amplified by a huge kind of local oscillator, which is your light fields in the cavities. Okay, so that's how you get the radiation pressure in there. And then for the vacuum fluctuations, some of them get reflected again to the output port, and that gives you your shot noise. Okay, so that's a simple intuitive picture to understand. We have these vacuum fluctuations. They come in from the this port here. Actually, they're all around it, but only the ones from this port actually make it into the interferometer and cause some damage there. So now let's think about how we can actually draw this and how we can get an analytical tool from that. And I just need to find this one here. So let's first of all have a look at how this whole thing works. So I have an input state. So that's my input state here, and we said that is this kind of sphere where, you know, the circle I've drawn here represents, I don't know, whatever probability value you want to set. So the highest probability is somewhere here, and then it fades out to the outside. So this is what I send in, and in order to make my life easier, and I should just make sure I use the same color convention as for the others. That one is blue. I represent this whole circle by actually two arrows in my two different quadratures. So instead of always drawing this arrow, this circle, I draw two arrows here. Okay, so they represent this whole circle. This is what I send in. Okay. So now what happens at the output, and we should make sure this one here is my phase quadrature, and this one here is my amplitude quadrature. So if I now look at very, very high frequencies, okay? So high frequencies means we don't need to care, we don't need to care about the radiation pressure noise because we are sitting somewhere very far out here. So this line we don't care about. So what happens then is the following. Oops. What we have is at the output state, we get the same in the amplitude quadrature. We get the same in the phase quadrature back. So nothing has changed. But in order to measure my gravitational wave, obviously somewhere on this needs to be my signal. Because recall, we always talk about noise relative to our signal, or the other way around. So where does the signal actually sit? Do I get my signal in the phase quadrature or in the amplitude quadrature? Anybody any suggestions? I have my interferometer, everything is nicely locked. And now I put a slight offset onto the end mirrors. It's first, if you do very, very large changes, you get it in the amplitude quadrature. But initially what you do is a relative phase measurement. If you think about it, you have your two waves and you overlap them. They are completely destructive interference. If you put them slightly away, that is actually what you see as the phase. So what I have here in addition is a tiny arrow, let's say, and that is my gravitational wave, okay? And now, if I want to look at my sensitivity, the only thing I have to do is to look at the ratio of the orange and the blue arrow, okay? The larger my orange arrow is, the better is my signal to noise, and the larger the blue one is, actually the more noise I get in the worse is my measurement. And I don't care about anything here in the amplitude quadrature, because I don't see this in my measurement here, the projection of A onto these two where my signal is zero. So now let's do the same thing at low frequencies. And I have my output here. So again, what I send in is exactly the same. It's just a vacuum state that doesn't have any frequency shaping. I have my phase quadrature and I have my amplitude quadrature. So what I get out is the following. I get my blue out. I get my amplitude quadrature. But now comes something interesting, because now we said we have some influence of radiation pressure noise at low frequencies. Okay, so at low frequencies here, we are not dominated by the shot noise, but actually by the radiation pressure noise. So how does that fit into this picture? So what happens is, let's make this here just to explain this a bit better. So what happens is, inside my interferometer at low frequencies, I have both the phase fluctuations and the amplitude fluctuations interacting with my mirror. The phase fluctuations don't do anything, but the amplitude fluctuations, they actually push my mirror around. Okay, so whatever fluctuations I have here, they are amplified, as we said, by your hundreds of kilowatts or megawatts local oscillator. So you look at the cross term. From this cross term at the frequencies in your detection band, the mirror actually gets a push, gets moved, and this causes, if I move my mirror, causes obviously a fluctuation in the phase of the light bouncing off the mirror. So what I get, and here's the interesting physics in all of this, what I get is now at low frequencies, I have this amplitude fluctuations, which I hadn't seen or didn't enter into my measurement at high frequencies. At low frequencies, this E1 arrow here, the green arrow, is actually, or part of it, is actually transformed or shifted into the phase quadrature, because the amplitude fluctuations move my mirror, the light bouncing off the mirror, the sensing one, actually sees a different phase, so I get this green arrow here on top, okay? And now the colors are important, because this green one here is actually correlated to my amplitude fluctuations, okay? So far here, that's why they have green colors, shot noise and amplitude in the phase quadrature is completely uncorrelated. What I do now here at low frequencies in my picture, and it's a very simple picture, is I get additional noise which has a correlation to what is in the amplitude quadrature, and now you see why actually my sensitivity curve at low frequencies goes up. Because now, if I look at the signal to noise ratio here at these frequencies, my signal is still the same, flat response, but my noise has increased by a lot, because I'm not only seeing the phase fluctuation, the phase quadrature fluctuations, but I also see the amplitude quadrature fluctuations transformed into the phase quadrature. So now I have some correlations, and we will see later on, you know, whenever you have correlations, it gets exciting and you can start to play with this and try to get some benefits out of this. Question? I don't think so. Sorry, I'm not get the vacuum fluctuations. Yeah, it's a noise. Yes. I don't think so, because I mean. So more or less you're saying that in my laser light, I have an imprint of the gravitational waves. So then I would say, if that is a measurable effect, why do I bother to building these 4 kilometer long things, and I just build my laser and use that to detect gravitational waves, if there would be such an effect. But we are not actually talking about the laser here, we are talking about the vacuum fluctuations. And I don't think the vacuum fluctuations will have I never thought about it, so maybe that's wrong, but at least I'm pretty sure the effect is very much negligible. Now the other thing which is very interesting about this arrow which comes out of the amplitude quadrature into the phase quadrature is that this is now proportional to a few things. So it's proportional to the power I put in. It's also proportional to the mirror mass or inverse proportional. And this one is now also frequency dependent. Okay, so this picture I've drawn here, the relative length of all of these arrows, is just kind of one example for one frequency. Okay, and for lower frequencies, this one gets larger and larger and larger. And we know that this is actually what should happen here, because if I go lower and lower in frequencies, this one gets larger and larger and larger, so my sensitivity goes actually, or the strain sensitivity goes up and up and gets worse and worse, because this green component gets larger and larger and larger. Okay, so I think that's hopefully a not too complicated picture, but we will see in a second that this is actually very, very useful. So with that, for example, you can explain easily all of these curves. So if you want to draw this at home or later on, just give it a shot. So now, as we have introduced this picture, we can start using it. And one way, the very simplest way actually, to get below the standard quantum limit is a so-called balanced somodyne detection or a variational readout. And we don't need to talk about much about the how you would actually realize this. For people who work in the experimental field, what you would do is, instead of having RF sidebands going down to your photodetector here to beat with your signal, or in the case of DC readout where you push your interferometer slightly off the dark fringe, you take another light field here just away from the laser where you can freely adjust the phase of it, just because this light goes a different path than the rest. So you can, you know, if I have a mirror here and push it by a few nanometers or so, then obviously I can change the phase, and I beat this. Is it clear why I need actually this local oscillator? Is that something that was covered so far? Okay, so you have your phase fluctuations in your interferometer, the gravitational wave, and now your signal comes out here. But the question is, how do I detect that there is a change at something like a few kilohertz or so? So if I have my source, and spiral source, it goes up to 1.5 kilohertz for neutron stars or so. So how can I see something at 1.5 kilohertz? Because what happens here is, again, you need to think about these light fields here. Your omega is optical. That means 10 to the 14, 10 to the 15 hertz. And that's, again, something that your photodiodes won't actually see. So you always have to, in order to read out the signal, you always need to beat it with another light field, slightly different frequency, but still in the order of 10 to 15 hertz. And then what you get is the beat frequencies. And one of the beat frequencies, if you X it out on paper, is obviously just the difference between the two frequencies. So if you start off with your laser light, take this down here, so that's your kind of your reference, and then you have here a light field which has some fluctuations on there at a kilohertz or at 100 hertz, then your beat note for this particular field is again at a kilohertz, and that's something you can detect with normal electronics. I mean, you could go and measure up to a few gigahertz or so, but definitely not 10 to the 14 hertz. Good, so that's one way how you see the signal. Yeah. In this particular case of a balanced homodyne, which is something which we currently don't use, but which will go into advanced LIGO Plus, and I think in many, many future interferometers, then you can choose the phase. And this is the key part here, because this phase now, what is the phase relative of my local oscillator and my signal, allows me, so far we always read out here in the phase quadrature, but now I can say, okay, I can turn, and for example, if I would like, I could read out this quadrature, I could read out this quadrature, and so on. So if we look at this, for example, if I say I would read out pure amplitude quadrature, wouldn't make much sense, because the only thing I get is noise, and my signal here, the projection is zero, so my signal to noise would be nothing over some noise, so not very clever. But the interesting thing is, if you go for slightly different angles, then you can do something fancy. For example, if you think about it, if we take this is my length of my of the correlations that I introduced from the amplitude quadrature into the phase quadrature, what I can do is I turn around my readout angle, and for a certain angle, there is a condition where the projection of E1 and the projection of this E1 are actually of the same length. But they point in different directions, okay? So I have correlated noise terms with different signs, so they actually cancel out. So I take this one out, I take this one out, and then my sensitivity is given just again by the ratio of the orange and the blue arrow, okay? And that is actually, if you look at this, this one to this one is the same as I would have here to here. So that's the same as what I just have at shot noise, where I don't have radiation pressure noise, okay? So here, in that sense, I have canceled the full radiation pressure noise that was transformed from the amplitude into the phase quadrature. The problem with this is, who spots the problem? Unfortunately, I haven't solved radiation pressure noise completely. What's the main problem here? Yeah? On the new mirror. Oh, no, 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 no. That because that one is kind of a tiny, tiny mirror or tiny amount of light, so you don't have radiation pressure on that one. Because you don't have the strong, again, as I said, you have the vacuum fluctuations you might have here, but you don't have this kind of 100 kilowatts or whatever to amplify this. This one will have 10 milliwatts or so, so the term is kind of a factor billion smaller. But good thinking. The problem I have is related to this F square here. The length of this green arrow here is frequency dependent, okay? So what I have shown you that I cancel these two works for one frequency. Okay, and as soon as I go away from that, then the length of these two is not the same anymore. So what you can do with this is the following. So this is a different interferometer. That's the sub-SQL interferometer at the Max Planck Institute in Hanover, so don't worry. Again, lots of noise curves here. But the key thing to see here is the red curve is the quantum noise of a standard Fabry-Perot-Michelson interferometer. We see here it touches the SQL at the point where the radiation pressure and the shot noise are equal in magnitude. And what you can do, for example, is now for 100 hertz, if I choose my readout angle so that at 100 hertz these two arrows have the same length, they cancel out, and I get back at this one frequency to the same level as I had here for the shot noise. Okay, so I've canceled my radiation pressure noise. But obviously at other frequencies, this doesn't work anymore. Okay, let's do this. If I go to very, very low frequencies here, then the problem is at very, very low frequencies, this arrow gets very, very, very long, and I don't have for this projection here, this one is too long and I only cancel it partly by this. Even worse, if I think about high frequencies now, what happens at high frequencies now? At high frequencies, what happens to this one here at high frequencies? It's zero, it's very, very small. But unfortunately, this one is frequency independent, okay? So at high frequencies, what I get is I have these two, they're again uncorrelated, so I can just add them up. And I need to make my SNR out of this green, this blue one, and this orange one. And that's why my sensitivity at high frequencies, if I do this, is actually worse. So what you can do with that, but still it's from the physics, I think something very interesting to do. And you can easily, with that very simple trick, you can see you can beat this fundamental standard quantum limit in this frequency range here by quite a bit. And here I just plotted how this would look like for different. And you can think of if you do different readout angles here, you can optimize for the different frequencies. And in principle, you could get the envelope here. Obviously not at the same time, because for each measurement time, you have to decide for one of these curves. So what you would need to do to get a perfect cancellation, and again that was proposed, is if I find a way to change this phase here, this readout angle, in a frequency dependent way, very complicated, then in principle you can compensate it because there is a way for each frequency to use the angle where these two would cancel out. Okay, and that is actually called variational readout. And I show you here what the sensitivity curve of that would look like. This is from a living review here. And you see here, this is your normal sensitivity curve. Here's a cavity pole. This is shot noise. Here comes your radiation pressure noise. And in theory, you could cancel all of this noise here. Looks absolutely brilliant. You get, you know, factors of 10, hundreds, and so on. Unfortunately, if you put in, and now comes this, you know, bloody experimentalists with their realistic mirrors and losses and so on, if you put real assumptions in there, then you get actually this red curve here, and you have not won much, unfortunately. But from the physics, it's a very nice nice way and a very interesting way to think about it. And the one thing you can think about right now, we come later to this, is how would I actually realize this frequency-dependent phase shift of my local oscillator? But that's something we will come to in a second anyway. Good. Is the speed okay? I realize I go about a third of the speed that I thought I would go, so we'll see how we get on. Yeah. Here, in this region, you mean? Oh, very, at very, very low frequencies, it gets harder and harder and harder, we will see. I mean, one of the techniques I dedicated my last kind of 6-7 years to is speed meters, which is kind of, at the moment, the prime candidate for doing this. At some point, you run again, always, in theory, everything is easy, but as soon as, you know, you have mirrors that you can actually buy, even if you invest millions and so on, at low frequencies, it gets harder and harder. But there's always a trade-off, because if you think about it, and we come to this when we talk about the third generation detectors, you need to always worry about how far can I actually go in my frequency space, because what you see here is that at low frequencies, it's not only one noise source, okay? So if I improve my quantum noise somewhere here, then I also have to do something with my coating noise. Maybe there's some magic. Suspension thermal noise, maybe there's something. Seismic, okay, you would need to put lots and lots of money on there. But the key one we will see later is here, this Newtonian noise curve, which is something where at the moment we don't have any good way of engineer it away. This is just simple gravity, and as long as nobody invents gravity shielding or anti-gravity or something like this, we are stuck with that noise curve, unfortunately, here on ground. So might be a different question if you think about LISA and going into space. Other questions? Okay, so then let's go and come to the state of the art, what everybody likes nowadays, and that's a hip topic, which is squeezed light. Okay, so squeezed light is again one of these techniques. I think it was first proposed 1988. Carlton Caves, I think, came up and said, you know, went through all of this here, obviously not with arrows. I think he did it with proper mass. But he said, you know, what happens if I'm able to somehow change the length of my input fluctuations here? So that comes back to this. We are thinking about, do I have my normal vacuum fluctuations, or do I have a squeezed vacuum field here? So that was done in 1988. And now again, just to get you into the timescales of gravitational wave detectors. So at that time, people did some squeezing with, I don't know, 1, 2, 3 dBs or something like this at megahertz and so on. But what you would need to apply it to our gravitational wave detectors and have some influence on the sensitivity is you need to have it at very low frequencies, audio band frequencies, and you need to get to factors of 10 dBs. And that actually happened between 2000 and 2005-ish or so, so 10, 15 years later, that people were able to develop that in the lab and have these kind of magic squeezing sources which could do and give you this squeezed vacuum. And that actually then enabled people thinking about how do we apply this to the gravitational wave detectors. And GEO 600 was actually one of the first, or the first to try it on a long baseline. I think we skip over these, so just to have a look, or maybe that's again intuitive. So this is just a different representation in addition to the vacuum state. So this is the same we had seen before. Here is actually the time series of all of this. This is what a coherent state looks like. So the difference to the vacuum state is that I have some classical amplitude here as well. So I'm not only having the ball, but I also have my stick here. Now we can think of what squeeze state actually looks like. Okay, and here for three different examples, you see what the squeeze state looks like. You have here a mixture of sine and cosine quadrature. You have here an amplitude squeeze state. Okay, so in your amplitude quadrature, you have a much smaller uncertainty, while in the phase quadrature, it's much larger. And here we can also do the opposite. We turn it around and have a coherent state which has a squeezed phase quadrature and an elongated noise or increased noise in the amplitude quadrature. So for the moment, just take this as a toolbox. Some people invented for you these light sources, and now you can play around with them and see how all of this works. Okay, so I think in order to speed this up, we're not drawing this here, but we're doing it on this board. So this is the same pictures as you had seen before. So this picture is the same as this. This picture is the same as this. And here I have my two input states. So the difference is at high frequencies, we only have the shot noise. And you recall at low frequencies, we have this radiation pressure component coming over from the E1. So what happens now if I increase or put in some phase squeezing? So what happens then? Let's first look at high frequencies. At high frequencies, I'm not starting off with a circle, but I'm starting off with lots of uncertainty in my amplitude quadrature and very little uncertainty in my phase quadrature. If I send this into my interferometer, see what actually comes out, then I have my large uncertainty here in the amplitude quadrature, very little in the phase quadrature, nothing has changed, but my signal to noise ratio between having no squeezing and putting in just vacuum fluctuations and the squeeze state is that my orange arrow is much larger, or the blue one is now much smaller than before, so I have improved my sensitivity. Brilliant. Okay, so I win at high frequencies, but now comes the usual thing. Nothing comes for free. We are still living in a world which is dominated by the uncertainty relation. If I now look what happens at low frequencies, I have my much larger amplitude fluctuations. Much larger amplitude fluctuations initially mean if I let them interact with my mirrors, the amplitude quadrature part, which is coupled into the phase quadrature, gets larger than before, if you compare it to this one. So actually, at low frequencies, I've lost. Okay, so squeezing, if you look at it, does more or less exactly the same. So this is the same picture I showed you before, where we changed the power. It's more or less the same as just changing my input power, okay? Has done nothing. I can still move up and down here on the interferometer. And actually, GEO has used it for a good reason, because people were not able to increase the power further. The lasers were there, but the interferometer was too unstable. So you could still improve the sensitivity by improving high frequency sensitivity and not caring about the low frequencies where other noise sources were dominant. So that's how people used it, and that's how we will use it, hopefully starting from February in advanced LIGO, that you say at low frequencies we don't care if it gets a little bit higher up because it's masked by other noise sources, but we care about getting the high frequency stuff a little bit down. But it's not your magic silver bullet which actually gets you below the SQL. Good. Still, just to give you a little bit of background here, yeah, that's for the experimentalists in the room, okay? Everything I show you here, you know, one ball, one arrow, looks all very simple, you know, beam splitter, two mirrors, it's a little bit more complicated in reality. So this is what this laser system, which produces a squeezed light state, kind of 10 dBs at audio bands, looks like. So this is, I think, a bench of 1.5 by 1 meter or so. I think people are now down to 0.8 square meter or so. People miniaturize it, but I think the price is still the same. So if you want to have such a box and someone is happy to build it for you, the material cost is about 200 to 300 kilo euros, dollars. Doesn't make much difference nowadays anyway. Okay, and I don't want to go through the details here. The key trick here, just to give you a little bit of an idea, well, I don't want to go too much into detail here. What happens during the squeezing is you start off with the laser frequency or wavelengths that you want to use. You upconvert to half the wavelengths, so twice the frequency, so that photons have twice the energy of what you want to use later on. And then you downconvert them. So you make out of one of these green photons, in our case, so you start with your infrared invisible light, you double it to 532 nanometers, and then in the parametric down conversion process, which I don't want to go into detail, you actually split them again into two photons at the same wavelength that you want to use. And now you see for energy conservation, if you go from one photon, split it into two, you start again, you know, you can think of correlations, and that in the end gives you this squeezing. The key part, as I said, is now you might wonder when I said, okay, in 2005 we had these light sources, why is advanced LIGO only now, 13 years later, actually implementing it? And that is, again, in the usual technical details. So how do I get my squeezed light actually into my interferometer? So here you see a picture. Let's see, this is actually for GEO. I have here my squeezed light source. Now I need to overlap it with my interferometer beam. So my interferometer sits up here. This is a single recycling mirror. So this is my output beam, which usually would go here, is filtered. Don't worry about this. And then I have here my main photodiode. So what I want to do is I need to have a magic device here, a so-called Faraday rotator, which lets some light coupling in here, but then when it comes back, it's not going again this way, but on the way back, it actually goes straight to the photodetector here. So this is how I inject my squeezing. But now what happens is I start off with my, let's say, my phase squeezed ellipse here in my squeezer, and now I inject it, and each of these mirrors here have a certain reflectivity. Let's say each of these has only 99% reflectivity. This is not because you can't make them better, but because you need to have some of these transmitted beams here in order to all of the different diagnostics and lock your interferometers and so on. So you have some losses in there, or some light being transmitted. And what happens there is that at each of these points, I take my original squeezing ellipse, take a little bit of it away, and replace it by vacuum states. Okay, so whenever you inject my light, this mirror has a certain loss here, a certain bit of my squeezed light is going this way, but at the same time, from this part here, a certain bit of normal vacuum state comes back in. And the same happens on all of these different points here. So the implementation is actually quite tricky, and you need to be quite careful about how much loss do you allow in this in order to get something. So here you see, if you start off with a squeezer which can do something like 10 dBs, unfortunately squeezers always love these dBs. I really hate it, you know, everything else we do in proper linear or logarithmic numbers, but somehow the squeezers like dBs. So you start off with your 10 dBs, which is a factor sort of 3 point and a bit, and now you see how much losses you can actually allow to get a certain effective squeezing as seen by a photodetector. And if, for example, you want to have 6 dBs of squeezing, then the most you are allowed in terms of loss is actually something like 10%, while in reality, I think GEO is at the moment, I think optimally at 20%, but in reality, it's actually 30%, okay? And the same will be true for LIGO. LIGO will actually aim in the next science run, I think, to get 3 dBs of effective squeezing. Okay, so it really depends on your losses. But it works, makes also much nicer pictures, you know, for magazines and so on, because suddenly, you know, you have at least one light source in all of your interferometers, which is actually visible and green, and you don't have just all of the 1064 nanometers. And you see here, you get factors of 3 to 4 dB in GEO 600, improved shot noise at high frequencies, okay? One other aspect to cover is, I mentioned, okay, you need to make sure that you don't lose some of your ellipse and replace it by vacuum states. The other thing is quite interesting. If you think about it, you have here your squeezing ellipse, okay? And we're still here somewhere in our coordinate system of amplitude and phase quadrature, and you have a fixed readout angle. What now can happen is, what happens if this angle of my squeezing ellipse is not fixed? You know, I have a slight wobble on there. A slight wobble could be from the fact that just some acoustics couple into this huge laser bench I showed you with all of the squeezers in there. And what would happen is that you would get over time, you know, with the fluctuations of a few hertz, let's say you have one mirror mount in there which wobbles at 50 hertz, and that means your squeezing ellipse does 50 hertz, something like this. Okay, so what I now actually would measure is not what I initially wanted to have, is kind of this level here in my phase quadrature, but I will get more something like this, okay? And that again decreases my sensitivity. So what this plot shows you here is again how much measured squeezing I would get depending on my total loss, but also how many milliradians of phase noise I have on the squeezing. This is kind of what you can actually afford. And unfortunately, while for search generation I will show you some plots, you know, we want to be somewhere in this region here, in reality right now we are either off the screen or somewhere up in the right hand corner. Good. So final thing about squeezing, and that's where the future lies, if you think about the advanced detector upgrades, is so-called technique frequency-dependent squeezing. Why don't I have the right plot here, I thought. Let me just check. Where is that? Oh, I killed the right plot. Anyway, okay, so what you want to do here is you want to get the full benefit of your squeezing at low frequencies and at high frequencies, okay? Here we said this is my normal sensitivity. Now I do phase squeezing and I actually get this blue curve here. What I would like to get is something where I have at high frequencies, where I'm dominated by this arrow here, the blue one, in my readout. I would like to have phase squeezing, but then at low frequencies here, where I know I'm dominated normally here by the one which is by the green arrow, which is translated from the amplitude quadrature to the phase quadrature, I want to have amplitude quadrature squeezing, okay? And this is something that you actually can achieve, very similar to variational readout actually, where you turn your squeezing ellipse. So at high frequencies, our squeezing looks like this. We have this very, very small E2 here with the signal on, we get a high SNR. And then at low frequencies, where usually we are dominated by this one getting very, very large, we have actually something where we are limited by the E1 transferred into our amplitude into the phase quadrature. So this one gets small, and this is still better, even though this E2 one here has a bigger contribution. So that's why this curve actually rises. But overall, you get the best squeezing at each of the frequencies. Okay, so very simple trick. It's just again the same as what we said for the variational readout. If I find you know, the right properties for each frequency, if I can somehow adjust my squeezing angle on the variation readout, my local oscillator phase, the readout angle per frequency, then I can do the best of all. And this is actually something you can do, and this is something, as I said, the NSF just approved, as far as I'm aware, a proposal where one of the key parts is to implement this for advanced LIGO in 2022. And here you see an early measurement from 2006 or 7 of this. This is my squeezed state here, not very strongly squeezed, but what people show here experimentally is that they can actually turn this ellipse in frequency space for different frequencies. All of this is in the megahertz range, but we think we can do the same actually for LIGO, Virgo, the Einstein telescope. How do you actually do this? The idea is to use your squeeze state. So you start with a normal frequency independent squeeze state, and then you use the dispersion you get in reflection of a Fabry-Pérot resonator. Okay, so if you think about the Fabry-Pérot resonator as a resonance system, obviously now you can tune your resonance, and then you know you get a phase flip for mechanical systems. If you think about a driven pendulum or something like this, you get a phase flip at the resonance. If you detune this from zero, then you can actually turn your ellipse in the right way at the right frequency. The challenge for all of this is actually shown in this plot, even though it's not very obvious here. If you think about, let's go back to, well, let's do this for A+. So this is actually what we think we will do for advanced LIGO+. this is a current sensitivity, or the O2 sensitivity from last year. Black one is the design sensitivity of advanced LIGO, what we hopefully might get by 2019 or so, or 20, I think. And then this is the proposal for 2022, and more or less all of what happens, if you recall, is that the pink curve is pushed down, and this is due to the frequency-dependent squeezing. So now let's think back on where might be the challenge here. The challenge was that we said, okay, you need to turn, you want to have at high frequencies where your shot noise limited phase quadrature squeezing, at low frequencies you want to have amplitude quadrature squeezing. So you need to turn it at the frequencies where these two are the same. And if we now go back to the advanced LIGO sensitivity, you might see where the problem here is. Too many slides. The problem is you need to somehow find a cavity where this dispersion occurs somewhere here around 50 hertz. Okay? So 50 hertz means you need to have a cavity bandwidth which is roughly 50 hertz. Okay? So now you can think of what you need to do. You need to have either a very, very, very long long cavity of a few hundred kilometers. Not very practical. Or you need to somehow change the bandwidth by making it very, very high Q resonator. Very, very high Q means you have a high finesse of the cavity. So the reflectivities of your mirrors are very, very, very high so that your light travels and travels and travels. So to virtually give you these hundreds of kilometers, okay? And that's the key thing here, because in order to do this, you can increase your finesse to incredibly high values, but incredibly high values also mean that my squeezed light photons, which I want to have actually reflected from this cavity, obviously they enter the cavity, if they go around quite a few times, let's say 10,000 times, they accumulate some loss. The cavity will always have some loss because there are some, the mirror surface is not ideal, or the end mirror has a certain reflectivity, and I will get vacuum states back in. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to decrease the finesse of my cavity while still keeping the same bandwidth, and that means I need to make it longer. And longer means in this case, while people originally thought, oh, we can do this here with kind of 100 meter cavities or 10 meter cavities, something where you say the cost is more or less negligible, we now find more and more that infrastructure changes, you know, really digging of and building of houses and new vacuum systems are needed in order to achieve these sensitivities. So for example, both advanced LIGO and advanced Virgo, not sure whether there was any coordination, by magic came to the number 300 meters is what they actually need for a filter cavity to get reasonably good sensitivity, not the ideal one. For all of the third generation interferometers, we think that probably in order to get the best squeezing, you need to have filter cavities which have the same length as your arms. Okay, so that means you have, you know, 4 kilometers, 4 kilometers, and then you have another tube of 4 kilometers actually next to it. Good, I think we're close to, as I said, oh, we started, when did we start? We started at 11:30 or at 11? 11, so we are more or less 1.5 hours in, oh? Okay, wow. Then I think we probably stop here and we continue with that on Monday. So the interesting things to come is actually something which we call optical rigidity and optical springs, where you actually do optomechanics. So you use your photons to actually control your mirrors and make your cavities stiff. So you can think of making connecting your mirrors by springs made of photons, which are similarly stiff to just putting some diamond between your mirrors. So quite some interesting physics in there. And then we can talk a little bit about the speed meters, and then we need to think where we put in the two-photon formalism, but we'll find a way. Can I just point out one thing before we close here? So I'll just go through all of this stuff here. But for if people are really interested to doing the third generation stuff, not only as lectures, but also a little bit as a workshop, and if you're completely bored because your team is losing in the World Cup or you don't know what else to do, can you actually have a look? There's it's amazing that all of these tools are not which were developed over 10, 20 years in the collaborations by many, many people are now freely available. So if you go to this Git, which is publicly available, GWING, Gravitational Wave Interferometer Noise Calculator, very descriptive name. Before it was called BENCH, because it was for benchmarking of different interferometer configurations. You get two versions of a very, very useful but still easy to understand tool. One is for everyone who likes more MATLAB, and the other one is a new version which is based on Python. And if you want and have some time, just have a look at this, and we will talk on Monday. I can show you some examples and what we can do with that. And then you can all develop your own third generation, fourth generation, fifth generation detectors with that. Okay, thanks very much. See you on Monday.